Zelda Breath of the Wild originally started off as a brand new entry in the series for the Wii U, but Nintendo producer Eiji Onuma one day told the team behind Breath of the Wild to port it over to their new console, the Nintendo Switch. And so, just like Twilight Princess, Breath of the Wild became both a launch title and a game for the previous console, though it should be said, after the team moved on to the Switch version, that one got the most focus, and it's the one that Nintendo really wants you to play. Neither Josh or myself have ever played the Wii U version, but from what we hear, the frame rate can often get very low. Not to the point of being unplayable, but certainly not as smooth as the Switch version. Plus, with the Switch version, you can also take it anywhere you want, rather than being restricted to the same room as the Wii U. But moving on from that, to some degree, Breath of the Wild is also a celebration of Zelda's 30th anniversary. The game was in development since around 2012, only a year after Skyward Sword came out, which celebrated the series' 25th anniversary. So naturally, Nintendo were going to take a little bit more time with the next 3D game. And as soon as you step out into Hyrule, you can see why Breath of the Wild took so long to make. You know how Ocarina of Time players back in the day thought that Hyrule was massive? Well, nearly 20 years later, Breath of the Wild managed to take that game and make it 100 times bigger. And the best part is that you can go anywhere you want at any time. Sure, you'll likely be kissing the ground a lot if you tread into an area you're probably not supposed to be in yet, but not since the original Zelda on the NES have we been given a choice to do whatever pleased us.
And obviously there's a lot more here than the first Zelda, so let's start with that plot. Now, since Breath of the Wild is still a somewhat new game, and this is a spoiler-heavy channel, we're still going to be talking about the whole story. Though we should stress that if you've played any other Zelda game before, then the plot shouldn't feel much different, but has a change of scenario. However, if you still don't want to find out what happens, then we'll give you a few seconds now. 100 years ago, Ganon used Hyrule Castle's robot protectors, called the Guardians, to cause destruction and despair against anything they touch, which eventually allows him to take over Hyrule. Only took him 3 decades worth of games, but yeah, he's finally taken over the world, rather than just a tiny marketplace and a castle he never leaves. Ganon's not more of an evil entity than a giant hog or a chuckling madman, but regardless, Princess Zelda, even 100 years later, has been keeping Ganon, now called Calamity Ganon, restricted to Hyrule Castle to prevent him from doing any more harm. Her appointed knight, who of course is Link, tried to fend off against Ganon and the Guardians to protect Zelda, but ended up gravely injured to the point of nearly dying, so Zelda orders the wandering Sheikah tribe to take Link to the Shrine of Resurrection and put him in some sort of cryo-sleep for 100 years. After finally waking up, Zelda instructs him to go out into Hyrule and stop Calamity Ganon. Time is of the essence though, as this old man you frequently meet with at the start turns out to be the spirit form of the Hyrule King, who could probably be the King of Red Lions from Wind Waker, but I'm not sure. He explains that Zelda's power to hold off Calamity Ganon is weakening, so Link needs to save her as soon as possible, when you're not running around completing side quests or exploring. Yeah, don't be discouraged, you're not on a time limit like in Majora's Mask. Zelda can hold him off a little longer, I'll just waste some time by climbing this mountain and locating a Korok from Wind Waker to give me a Maraca Seed.
But because of Calamity Ganon's terror, 4 of Zelda's so-called champions, who all have close relationships with Link, are axed off. Their walking mechanical weapons, known as the Divine Beasts, have been corrupted by Ganon and are causing trouble in each of the 4 respective regions of Hyrule. For the sake of having a complete story, Link will need to free the Divine Beasts from Ganon's clutches in order for the champion's spirits to be released, so that they can use the Divine Beasts to assist Link in the final battle. It's a bit unclear as to why the champions have the Divine Beasts to begin with, though. Presumably they were made as weapons of peace to Hyrule, but why would they need such large laser beams that can travel hundreds of miles? But sure enough, Link successfully unshackles the Divine Beasts and he storms through Hyrule Castle to take on Calamity Ganon, who's now taken form because Zelda couldn't hold onto her power anymore. The champions use the Divine Beasts to help lower his health by half, and honestly, that just makes the fight even simpler than it already is. For someone who's wiped out the whole of Hyrule, Calamity Ganon isn't actually that hard to beat, especially if you've upgraded your armor sets and stocked up on health replenishments and elixirs beforehand. Maybe it's because you're a little overpowered after clearing through the Divine Beasts, but the only difficult thing about Ganon is how much health he has, and even though he becomes bigger and meaner during the second phase of the battle, the light arrows take away so much health that it makes this part even easier than the first.
In no time at all, Calamity Ganon is defeated and Zelda's free from his grasp to deliver the coup de grace. She thanks Link for his efforts, and that's actually where the game ends. There's a post-credit scene where Link and Zelda say goodbye to the King and the Champions, as well as a secret cutscene when you find all the memories, but there's not really much resolution. There's no ritual, we don't see the townspeople celebrate Ganon's demise, The story just sorta stops, and Zelda says there's still more work to do. We're not gonna lie, that's kind of a lame-ass ending. What exactly was the point in saving Hyrule if nobody apart from Zelda was going to acknowledge Link's bravery other than just, "Kay, thanks"? This is a pretty long game we have here too. Around 40 to 50 hours with even more time if you're doing a bunch of the side quests. I'm sure there are a number of people that would have wanted Link and Zelda to get together, but I would have even been perfectly fine seeing me for the Zora champion getting together with him. She flat out proclaims that she's in love with Link after spending a lot of time with him in the past. But because Ganon's killed her, she can only be with him in spirit. That's harsh.
Breath of the Wild's story overall has an intriguing concept, but in the end it's the same one we've heard for over 30 years. The Triforce isn't even brought up in this game, and yet it still goes through the motions. You wake up, you go outside, the world's in shit, you sort it out. I mean, if it ain't broke, don't fix it, and the story is still that classic fantasy tale, but something a little different would have been nice. There could have been a little more effort put into the story, but thankfully the gameplay almost makes you forget about it because it's so damn fun. Zelda's now a massive sandbox game, and boy is the sandbox massive. Hyrule is now your playground to run around in, and you can explore wherever you want, whenever you want. Sure, you could go talk to the old man after leaving the Shrine of Resurrection, or you could go fight some bokoblins with a tree branch and climb a random mountain in hopes of finding a secret.
And climbing is a major addition to Breath of the Wild. Almost everything is climbable and damn near essential if you want to go anywhere in this game or scout the area more easily. In particular, if you want to locate these new shrines, which are basically mini dungeons that contain no more than a couple of puzzle-filled rooms, where upon completion you're rewarded with a spirit orb, and once you've obtained four of these, you can transfer them to one of the Hylian goddess statues in exchange for a heart container, or a slight increase in your stamina gauge, making a welcome return from Skyward Sword. Stamina is pretty much used for everything, including sprinting, climbing, special attacking, and also paragliding when you eventually get it. Paragliding is a godsend for traveling in this game, trust me. With all this in account, like I said earlier, you can go wherever you want, and the shrines also act as fast travel points when you use your Sheikah Slate on them. This obvious Switch handheld lookalike that acts as one giant key, in addition to also bringing up your map and your photo album of old and new memories when you get the camera ability. Say keys!
Speaking of memories, you can also find specific spots around Hyrule to help Link gain his memory back by showing different flashbacks about his relationship with Zelda and the Champions. There isn't nearly as much romantic tension between Link and Zelda as there was in Skyward Sword, but there are a few little hints here and there. The memories can be pretty hard to find, but thankfully the landscape painter in some of the stables can give you the general direction of where they are, so there's still some exploring to do for the memories, but you're not totally lost. Stables are also a way of registering horses that you can tame and make your own, but you won't be using them that often because there's not a lot of space for horses to travel in, and the controls are pretty shit, both intentionally and unintentionally. What I mean is that horses need to bond with you first by petting them after performing certain tasks, like jumping and just generally doing what you tell it to do. And after doing that enough times, the horse lets you control it more how you want it to. However, even with a Pona who has max bonding stats, she only controls slightly better than the wild horses just starting out. So horses are rather useless in this game, and you're probably better off traveling on foot. It doesn't have to be a horse you can ride though. You can choose a deer or a giant grizzly bear, both of which surprisingly control better than the horses do.
At least Link himself controls smooth as butter compared to previous Zelda games. My god, he actually has a jump button! Accidentally leaping off of ledges is now a thing of the past, and we'd highly recommend using the Switch's Pro Controller for the most fluent controls. Combat, on the other hand, is surprisingly a lot more simplistic than Twilight Princess, which allowed you to learn different fighting techniques, as well as Skyward Sword from being able to swing your sword in any direction. The only new fighting ability Link has in Breath of the Wild is slowing down time and unleashing a flurry of attacks if he dodges an enemy just before he gets hit. The timing can be a bit tricky, but if you can pull it off, it's damn satisfying. You definitely need to brush up on your combat skills for the tests of strength in some of the shrines as well. Breath of the Wild can get a little carried away with these, and they're the most abundant types of shrines in the game. So Link's definitely a hell of a lot more nimble than some of his previous incarnations, but Breath of the Wild wants you to focus more on exploration rather than brute force. It's not like combat was an afterthought, that's for sure, because this is a hard game. And I'm not kidding when I say that, even the first bunch of enemies you come across can kill you in a couple of hits, maybe not even that. Link may be more agile even after his big slumber, but his endurance is awful when you begin. It's not quite as difficult as the original Zelda, and definitely not Zelda 2, but it still ain't holding your hand or going soft on you. This game will test you, and after playing the other 3D entries, it can throw you off a little. People often like to compare this game to Dark Souls and how it plays, and I can agree with that to some extent. There's that old saying in video games, simple to play but hard to master when it comes to Breath of the Wild, either by increasing your hearts, experimentation with different items, or trying to find the best weapons you can because there's now durability in Link's arsenal. Using a weapon too much will eventually cause it to break and you can't get it back. The same goes for shields, especially if you're riding with it on rough ground. Some equipment are more durable than others, and you're naturally gonna find better weapons as you search high and low, but it's heartbreaking heartbreaking when you find a weapon you really like, and you know it unfortunately has to leave you at some point. The only exception to this is the Master Sword, which you need at least 13 hearts to pull out of its pedestal and prove your worth, reminiscent to upgrading your sword in the original Zelda. On the one hand, it's a good incentive to explore for shrines, and you feel more like you've earned the Master Sword, as opposed to figuring out a conceptually simple puzzle beforehand like in the other games. But on the flip side, the Master Sword does run out of power when used enough times, and it takes around 10 minutes to recharge before you can use it again. The Blade of Evil's bane, and it constantly needs new batteries like a Wiimote.
Durability doesn't apply to clothing for some reason, where some of them provide stat buffs and wearing the whole set gives you different results, like the Barbarian set that increases your attack power, or the Climber set that lets you climb faster. You can even ask the Great Fairies of Hyrule to beef up your armor's defenses up to 4 levels in exchange for monster parts and star fragments that sometimes fall from the sky, but the more you improve them, the more materials are needed, and the more rare they can be. But for the love of God, don't equip anything metal during a lightning storm, because that'll happen. Weather can drastically affect Link's progress. If he's on a snowy mountain, he's gonna freeze. If he's by lava, he's gonna burn. If he's in the desert, he'll both freeze and burn during the day or night, all of which gradually deplete your hearts. Not to mention Hyrule has the most frequent rainy days I've ever seen. There is so much rain in this game. All climbable surfaces become soaking wet and Link slips every few steps, impeding on your climbing and wasting stamina. It makes sense, but does Link really have to slide so far back down every couple of seconds? You're not climbing a tower of mud, it's just a bunch of rocks. But anyway, you can help Link become more accustomed to the climate by wearing certain clothing, eating particular food to cool him down or warm him up, or using the environment around him such as campfires. Cooking is another big inclusion to Breath of the Wild, and it's the only way to replenish your health without traveling to towns and resting at an inn. Different ingredients can be found in the wilderness, and can occasionally drop from enemies, but you can also hunt for food with your bow and arrow.
Let's be a bit overkill and use bomb arrows on this Kuko. Ow, ow, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to blow up your friend, I swear! Here, attack them instead! Okay, so if you'd rather not do that, you can get food in a faster and less violent way by using different Zelda amiibos to have them drop in front of you. As a bonus, you'll get a treasure chest that gives you a different weapon, some of them from previous games like the big Goron sword from Ocarina of Time, or a chance to obtain a piece of Link's green outfit from past titles. You can get the outfit from the original NES game, on top of the Wind Waker, which clashes art styles horribly, by the way, the darker Twilight Princess clothing, the Skyward Sword garments with the Goddess sword, as well as Fierce Deity Link from Majora's Mask with his sword included. There's additionally a monster shop where you can trade monster parts for currency in order to buy exclusive gear, like the mask you can use to blend in with that type of enemy, or also Dark Link's armor to let you run faster at night. These can be very expensive, but we'd highly recommend getting these, especially the Dark Link armor, as it helps reduce traveling time.
It definitely helps with finishing the side quests more quickly too, though I'm not as eager to do some of these, no matter how weird these characters can be. Most of them are fetch quests, and a fair few of them can handsomely reward you, but most of the time you just get rupees and I'm left feeling empty. Like I said, however, the select few can benefit you greatly, such as the Thunderhelm side quest, where upon completing all of Gerudo Town's side quests, you can wear this huge helmet to become impervious to lightning strikes. Or, if you use this blue flame to light up this house in Akala, you can trade in bolts and gears and a bunch of rupees to purchase special equipment that fend off against these highly dangerous robots called Guardians. Usually, when you see these guys, you think, "Crap, crap, crap, oh no!" But as soon as you buy the ancient arrows and pierce their eye to kill him in one hit, oh, that feels good. Or you can always deflect their lasers back with your shield by parrying at the right time, which I didn't find out until near the end of the game, and I also didn't realize you could break their legs and provide the same effect.
But that's a good example of Breath of the Wild giving you freedom of choice. You don't have to face enemies head on, you can always sneak behind them and do major damage. You don't have to wait to fight Ganon, you can go straight to him from the tutorial area, and you don't have to tackle a game's four dungeons in any specific order. Yep, we're back to four dungeons, similar to Majora's Mask with a focus on side stuff, not only to expand the world, but also to help you last longer in the field. The shrines are undoubtedly the biggest giveaway to this, and while the puzzles can be brain-taxing, the four proper dungeons in the Divine Beasts are the biggest and most puzzle-filled in the game. They are also arguably the most complicated dungeons in the entire series, as you need to move the Divine Beasts in a certain way to solve puzzles and make progress, although they're no water temple. It's a shame that all the dungeons have a common gimmick of activating numerous terminals to activate one giant terminal, but we think it makes up for it by making each terminal a different challenge to reach. It's also a shame, however, that there aren't different items you can find inside the dungeons. That's usually one of the best parts about the previous games, being rewarded with an awesome new tool that gives you something to look forward to. But in Breath of the Wild, you're given all of your items within the first four shrines. The bombs are self-explanatory, and are a continuing staple to the series. Magnesis lets you pick up and attract or repel heavy objects to solve puzzles, or beat the living shit out of enemies, even bosses like the Hynix. Cryonis builds blocks of ice from any body of water, allowing you to climb up and use them as platforms. And finally, stasis allows you to freeze certain objects, and later enemies, in place, and hitting it multiple times while in this state stores potential energy that later becomes kinetic energy after it's unfrozen. Basically meaning you can launch the objects however far you want. All of these abilities are great additions, and hopefully they'll return for future Zelda games.
But back to the Divine Beasts. The boss fights at the end are sadly not that spectacular for Zelda standards. They're not terrible, but they all play pretty similarly, and if you get the Master Sword beforehand, they're absolute pushovers. Thunderblight Ganon can kiss my ass, though, that's all I'll say about him.
Actually, I quite liked how challenging Thunderblight Ganon was, in an otherwise underwhelming lineup of relatively easy boss fights.
But at least the music for the bosses are pretty cool. Actually, let's talk about the music quickly, or lack thereof. On the occasion while you're trudging through the fields or climbing a mountain, you get a nice serene piano piece, and when there are enemies the music will get faster and a bit more tense as the fight goes on. But aside from that, you'll just be listening to the outdoors of Hyrule, which is calming, but maybe a few more music pieces that are a little bit more frequent would have made the game more glamorous. Not to mention that the music itself, with some exceptions, isn't all that memorable, which for a Zelda game is rather disappointing. Not awful, just disappointing. Put it this way, I think Breath of the Wild's best music out of the entire soundtrack comes from the trailer. That's probably not a good sign.
The only thing left to say about Breath of the Wild is the DLC. The last pack came out fairly recently, and when the season pass was first released, the DLC we got was pretty bare. But nowadays, for £18, it could be a lot worse. The expansion bonus gives you this Nintendo Switch shirt that you can totally use to defeat Calamity Ganon, and as for aesthetics, the two packs give you masks and outfits based on previous games, with a couple of them having different perks. For example, the Majora's Mask that lets you blend in with enemies, or the Korok Mask that shakes whenever a Korok seed is nearby, which is useful for collecting enough of them to expand your inventory space via a giant Korok named Hetsu. There are 900 seeds in total, so I hope you've got a lot of time on your hands if you're up to finding them all.
There's also a 45-floor gauntlet that permanently powers up your Master Sword after completing it and increases the durability when you've done them all, but it's freaking difficult because you're stripped of your equipment and you have to build yourself up again. It's split into three tiers as well, beginning, middle, and final trials, but if you die in any of them, you have to start from the very first floor of that tier, which sucks so hard if you spent a long time getting very high up. In addition, the first DLC pack has a feature that follows the pathways you take and show you what you've explored from the past 200 hours, as well as a travel medallion that lets you place a warp point you can go back to, and a hard mode where the enemies are tougher variations with regenerative health. I would have thought this would be included in the game already, but surprisingly not. The second DLC pack that came out just a couple of months ago was definitely better in my opinion. This one tasks you to find a Divine Beast for Link to control, but in order to do that, he has to pass these trials from the champions, and by that I mean keep running around and use their vague hints to find more shrines that'll give you medals to access a rematch with their respective boss fight. Okay, those parts aren't that exciting, in fact they can get pretty dull and tiring, but completing all of them does unlock a brand new dungeon, and this is easily the most challenging one in the game. I enjoyed the exclusive boss in this place too, it was a nice final test before finishing, and once you conquer the task, you're rewarded with your Divine Beast, which turns out to be nothing more than a motorcycle. Kinda lame that it's not as big as the other Divine Beasts, but oh yeah, this bike is sweet!
I don't know what you're getting so excited for, you can't even use it until you practically cleared the game.
I know, but do you have any idea how long I've been traveling on foot and now I can summon this bike whenever I want?
But the DLC lets you do that with horses too.
Yeah, but the bike doesn't run out of stamina.
It runs out of fuel though.
So, you can use any material to fuel it back up again, and stuff like bokoblin horns are so abundant anyway that it should never be an issue.
What, was plutonium not an option?
Oh, just give your thoughts on the game already.
Overall, I love Breath of the Wild. Next to Persona 5, I definitely thought that this was the best game of 2017. It has a few little annoyances, but they never overshadow just how fantastic the experience is. Josh and I didn't even realize how long we'd been playing until we eventually looked at the Switch's clock time, and it left our mouths gaping wide open in shock. I hope that a lot of developers take a cue from Breath of the Wild about how much can be changed to make their series fresh and for modern audiences. It takes the best aspects of previous Zelda games while adding a bunch more, and that's how games should progress. You figure out what works and expand upon that. The story is still fairly shallow, but that doesn't stop Breath of the Wild from being a well-crafted game. I'm more of an exploring type of gamer, and I spent way more time discovering each area of Hyrule than I did trying to finish the story. It's a game that caters to all types of players that can go at their own pace, either by taking the time to explore or going straight to the end for a greater challenge.
Breath of the Wild is a fantastic Zelda title and an all-around amazing game in general. I can't think of another game that's as open, expansive, and free-roaming as Breath of the Wild. And someday I'd like to do a straight-to-Ganon run on YouTube because it sounds like it could be fun. I also adore the numerous Easter eggs you can find, like the Twin Cliff Peaks from the original Zelda, and an abandoned Lon Lon Ranch from Ocarina of Time. The newly added voice acting isn't too bad either. Not amazing, but compared to the cartoon and especially the CDI games, it's quite the upgrade. I honestly wasn't sure if they'd ever try again after Metroid Other M got so much flack for its voice acting. But I'm glad Nintendo have finally given it a shot with the Zelda series. And with the amount of tools you can use, playing how you see fit, tons of stuff to do and collect, a peaceful and sometimes epic orchestral soundtrack, and an absolutely beautiful setting makes this one of my new all-time favorite games. I wasn't bored yet when the original Zelda came out, and it was intended as a game to discuss with friends and pass on tips and secrets. But I'd like to think Breath of the Wild has recreated that experience, because I love talking about this game with friends and family, and I enjoy looking up online forums and articles about what there is to find. But now I'm wondering how Nintendo's gonna top this one. This is probably their biggest game yet, so they're gonna have to try really, really hard to impress us next time. Who knows, they may have something else up their sleeves, but we shall see.
Hey, I've been meaning to ask, what's going on with your Phantom Pain review? It's been out for 2 years now. Yeah, but 2 years is a pretty long time.